Yes, brother.
Thank you very much. In view of the obvious threat to our children in the public school system, the threat of immorality and moral corruption and anti-religious influences, because I have seen propaganda being distributed, magazines like New Youth Connections, which teach children things that are absolutely corrupt and abnormal, etc. I won't mention details since this is a house of God. What, if any, attempts are being done by the Muslim community to protect the Muslim children? I mean, are they attempting to take them to religion, to all-day parochial or religious schools, or also the New York state law permits homeschooling by parents to take children out of the public school? This, I believe, is permitted. Are there these efforts within the Muslim community? And I ask this as one who is not a Muslim, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to be here. I'm a great admirer. I have a great admiration and respect, sincerely, for Islam. But is there some effort to protect the children from these terrible immoral influences in the school? Thank you.
Brother, I just like to make clarification. You said that in the school, there is something against something. You said, I didn't get that word clearly.
In the public school.
In the public school, there's something against Islam.
Against morality.
Against morality.
Teaching about homosexuality, abortion, etc., condoms, and all these. I'm sorry to mention this.
That's right. But the brother asked a very good question, that in public schools, you have teachings which are against morality, like homosexuality, about abortion, and various sexual things, etc. Do we in Islam have certain schools, since the government gives permission that you can have Islamic schools, have we made an effort? Brother, regarding the first part of the question, that all these immoral teaching comes when there is co-education, more of co-education. I'll first deal with that and then the second part of the question. There was a survey done in UK, in the schools, and when they asked the teachers of the school, they said that students in unisex schools, they concentrated much better than students in the co-ed school. Because in co-ed school, the students, they spend more time in trying to impress the opposite sex than on paying attention to what was taught by the teachers. Same out here in America, according to New York Times, as well as the Time magazine, it said that 25% of the women going to university, they are raped. And says that in American school, the children learn more about sex than what is taught to them by the teachers. And recently, I read in several papers, not once, at least five times in my short stay, I learned that there was most of the male student, they try and harass the female student. And when the female student takes an objection, no one hears them. And yesterday I just read in the papers, I don't know which paper it was, it had come in the front page, that once a young girl, she was molested by a student, 14 years old student. When she complained and the principal gave a warning to the student that if you do it again, you will be rusticated. He again repeated the act. When the principal rusticated that young boy of 14 years, the board of school, they took objection that you cannot rusticate a student. Imagine, he molests a girl and the education board supports him. I do agree with you that the society is going down. It's becoming immoral. Therefore, in Islam, we do not encourage intermingling of sexes. Intermingling of sexes is haram, it's forbidden, and we encourage the students that preferable go in unisex schools. If you go to unisex schools, but natural, this immorality will become less. Regarding the second part of the question, that since the government gives permission that you can have homeschool, etc., are we making any effort out here? I'm not very well aware of America, but I do know in several parts of the world that there are Islamic schools. And we see to it that there's a striking balance, alhamdulillah, that besides teaching them the normal curriculum of the government, what should be taught. I'm talking about the moral things, not the immoral things. The moral things. History, geography, science, etc. Besides that, we even teach our moral values of the Quran and the authentic hadith. Now, instead of the class being maybe from 9 to 3, it's from 9 to 5, 2 hours additional. So that this 2 hours additional knowledge of the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. Or instead of 5 days a week, the Islamic schools run for 6 days a week. There are several in the world, in South Africa, in London, and I believe there are a few also in the States, in Chicago, in Atlanta, and surely there will be New York also. I don't know about them, but there will be. Besides that, we also have weekend schools. That if we can't give them the Islamic knowledge, Islamic moral teachings, in the public school, they go to weekend school, which is on Saturdays and Sundays, or only on Sunday or only on Saturdays, where they get the moral values, so that they at least remain on the true path. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Thank you.
Wa alaikum assalam.
With reference to food here, some Muslims say it's okay to eat what is kosher or just say bismillah and eat anything else except pork, of course. I would like if you can elaborate a little on what the Sharia says this question of food, halal and haram. And is it okay to eat the kosher?
Sister has asked a question regarding haram and halal foods. Sister has given the talk, scientific reasons for dietary laws in Islam, and they have spoken in detail regarding haram and halal. There are several things which are haram and halal. Just to mention a few, the Quran says in no less than 4 different places, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 173, in Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 3, in Surah Anam chapter 6 verse number 145, and Surah Nahl chapter number 16 verse number 115, it says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتُتُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمِ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ. That means forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah has been invoked. These four things are prohibited. There are other things also prohibited by beloved Prophet, that any carnivorous animal that is having claws and canine teeth, it's prohibited. Quran says in Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 90, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you believe, innamal khamru al maisuru, most certain intoxicants and gambling, wal anzabu al aslamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rishtum min amali shaitan, these are Satan's handiwork, fashtanibu lakum tuflihun, abstain from such handiwork that you may prosper. That means alcohol is prohibited, gambling, etc. Regarding the scientific reasons, I have given my cassette. But what I feel, sister, that though your question was very broad-based, what is halal, what you're really meaning to ask is that is food like McDonald's, chicken, mutton, is it allowed or not? Sister, is that a main question? That can we have chicken from McDonald's, say bismillah and have it? That's right. Though your question was broad-based, what is haram and halal? You can go talk on that. You can speak the full day. This question has been following me everywhere. I went to Atlanta, they asked. I went to Houston, they asked the same question. I went to San Antonio, they asked the same question. I'm here, they're asking the same question. That is having chicken and mutton from McDonald's and Kentucky allowed or not? And since I've asked this question, I know the background. Because Yusuf al-Qardawi, he's a great scholar. I've read his book and I respect him. I really refer to his book for several of my answers. He said that since the Quran says people of the food of the people of the book is allowed, you can have it. What Yusuf al-Qardawi, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi is referring to is Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 5. He says, lawful for you from today is the food of the people of the book, and your food is lawful for them. Means for you, the food of the people of the book is lawful, and for them, your food is lawful. So that means you can have the food of the Ahl-e Kitab. But when the question is posed to Yusuf al-Qardawi, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi, is pork allowed? He said, no, pork is not allowed. He said, why? Because pork is prohibited in the Bible. Therefore, even if the people of the book serve you pork, you can't have pork. This is the answer given by Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi. That's the reason I'm told that most of the Arabs here, they feel that if you have mutton or chicken from Kentucky or McDonald's, it becomes halal. Now, point number one, you should realize that they are basing the argument on the four verses I quoted. Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 173, Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 3, Surah An'am chapter 6 verse number 145, and Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse number 115, which says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتُدُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمِ الْكِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أَهُلَّا رِجَالٍ لَبِهِ. That is forbidden for you for food, dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah has been invoked. Means if on the food any name besides Allah has been invoked, it becomes haram for you. So since the Ahle Kitab out here, the Christians, they don't take the name of anyone other than Allah. Neither do they take Allah's name, neither do they take any name. Therefore, this food becomes halal for you. I would like to point out to them that we as Muslims should not follow only few verses of the Quran. We should follow the whole Quran. Quran clearly states in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 118 and verse number 119, that you should only have the meat of that meat on which Allah's name has been taken. Quran says in Surah An'am, chapter 6, verse number 118, that the name of Allah should be taken on the meat, otherwise it is haram for you. So based on some verses of the Quran, Kentucky is allowed. So if you want to follow part of Islam, then you can have the food of Kentucky. But if you want to follow full Islam, the whole of the Quran, Quran clearly states in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse number 118 that name of Allah should be taken. Since in Kentucky and McDonald's, I doubt whether they take the name of Allah, therefore it becomes haram for you. You're not following the full Quran. Now coming to the argument of Yusuf al-Qardawi. Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi said that since pork is haram, mentioned in the Bible, therefore it is not the food of the people of the book. So even if a Christian gives you pork, it is haram for you. I agree with Sheikh al-Qardawi that the Bible says in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verse number 7 and 8, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8, and the book of Isaiah, chapter number 65, verse number 2 to 5, it says that the flesh of swine is prohibited for the Jews and the Christians. Therefore, pork is haram. Fine. But Yusuf al-Qardawi, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi forgot that the Bible clearly mentioned in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 17, verse number 15, and in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 21, that dead meat is also prohibited. Bible says in no less than 5 different places that blood is prohibited. In the book of Leviticus, chapter number 17, verse number 14. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 12, verse number 16. In the book of Genesis, chapter number 9, verse number 6. In the 2 Samuel, chapter number 14, verse number 33. And in the book of Acts, chapter number 15, verse number 29. No less than 5 places the Bible says blood is prohibited. So even a Christian should do Zabiha. If he's not doing, he's not following the Bible. So based on the argument of Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi, he did not know that even the Bible says blood is prohibited and even dead meat is prohibited. So based on this argument, even doing Zabiha is compulsory for Jews and the Christian. Alhamdulillah, the Jews do Zabiha. So you can of course have the food which is kosher of the Jews. But of the Christians which don't do Zabiha, you cannot have. And one more criteria is required, that the name of Allah should be taken. So if a Jew does not take the name of Allah, even that's haram for you. I know many people will argue, because when the moment I give this answer, most of the Arabs, they come and they say, Sheikh bin Baz said this, Sheikh so-and-so said this, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi said that. I said, see, if you can get me the name of 10 sheikhs who said that having Kentucky is halal, I can get you 20 sheikhs who said it is haram. We Muslims should not follow any sheikh. I have respect for Sheikh bin Baz. I have respect for Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi. I respect them. I refer to their books. But you should realize all of these are human beings. Even I am a human being. You should not follow what I say. You should not follow what a sheikh says. You should follow what the Holy Quran says. Holy Quran clearly prohibits in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse number 118 that meat on which the name of Allah has not been taken, it is haram for you. So surely, whether it be Kentucky, whether it be McDonald's, if you have any meat which is not Zabiha, which the name of Allah has not been taken, whether it's served by Ahl-e-Kitab, even if it's served by the Muslims, even even if it's served by a Muslim, and if it's a haram meat, it is haram for you. If unknowingly if you have it, unknowingly if I go to a Muslim's house, and if I don't know that it's zabia, and if I have, inshallah, Allah will forgive me. Because Allah says, unwillingly if you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is Rahman or Rahim. But otherwise, if you know for sure it is not zabiha, the name of Allah is not taking, you should not have it. People told me in San Antonio that, see, we don't get zabiha meat. They failed to realize that when I'd come earlier in states, it was difficult for me to find halal meat. But now, alhamdulillah, in New York, there are several restaurants which sell halal meat. In San Antonio, there are. In Atlanta, there is. But the question is, halal meat, for £1, you have to pay maybe $1 extra. The other meat, it is cheap. To get halal meat, you may have to travel 1 mile extra. So in order to save the trouble for us, we try and find loopholes, which is wrong. If you want to be a Muslim, you have to follow all the verses of the Holy Quran. And I hope that answers the question, sister.
I'm sorry, just small questions.
Yes, I know that the moment I give this answer, there has to be a follow-up, and I welcome it.
Follow-up, yeah, because this is something very important.
Yes.
Muslim, obviously, if the slaughter of the animal, even if it's saved in the name of Allah, as far as the intention,
it's in the name of Allah, that's acceptable. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is coming to Zakurukum, and in Hadith al-Qudsi says, Mazakarani fi nafsu zakartuhu fi nafsu.
I agree with you.
So, if Inshallah. Muslim has the intention
Alhamdulillah.
To slaughter, even if he didn't say it or announce it, that's not forbidden.
Of course. Alhamdulillah. Innama al-amala bin niyyah. If intention is there, fine. I mean, that's fine. If the intention is there, slaughtering.
Of course.
Of course, it's halal for you.
Of course. Sister, questions there?
Yes, I have a problem.
Go ahead, please.
Question.
Yes.
One of the procedures that's done, it means one utterance is done by the rabbi, and the animal is in mass, they are slaughtered. Now, we also know that that group of Jews who slaughter the meat in that manner, the Orthodox Jews do not partake of that meat. So I'm wondering if there are other nuances that Muslims need to be apprised of in reference to this question. And ultimately, and this is on the economic side, even if the meat of Ahli Kitab is halal for Muslims, at what point can we begin to move our own economic basis and support our own by purchasing meat that is slaughtered by Muslims?
Sure. So that's two questions.